I am Cathy, and in this video series, I will be covering arterial blood gas interpretation, or ABG interpretation. I'll be covering a number of topics, including the ABG components and what the normal expected ranges of each component are. We'll talk about buffers in the body that help maintain acid-base balance. We'll go through the steps on how to interpret an ABG result. And we will also talk about the causes, the symptoms, and treatment for different acid-base imbalances. And then finally, I'll go through a number of practice problems to really get you comfortable with interpreting ABG results. So as I go through this video series, I will be following along with my cards that are available on leveluprn.com. It's kind of a mini deck. You don't need to have these cards to find value in this video series. However, it is really helpful to have the information on these cards for reference, whether you're a nursing student or a nurse. So what is an ABG? An ABG is an arterial blood sample that is used to assess the acid-base balance, the ventilation and oxygenation of a patient. These are often critical care patients, but I also had patients when I worked on the med-surg telefloor who would get ABG tests done routinely. So like I said, it's an arterial blood sample. So this is not a venous blood sample. We need to get it from an artery. So we're not pulling it out of a PICC line. We either need to take that arterial blood sample out of a functioning arterial line, and patients who have arterial lines are typically in the ICU, or we can get it through a puncture. So at my hospital and at many hospital systems, the respiratory therapist is the one who actually comes and does the blood draw for an ABG. So they will typically get that blood sample from the radial artery. Before they do the puncture, however, they do what's called an Allen's test. So an Allen's test is done to make sure that we can get adequate blood flow through the ulnar artery while we're messing with that radial artery. So with the Allen's test, we're compressing both of those arteries, and the hand will get kind of pale and cool. We'll let go of the ulnar artery, but keep compressing the radial artery to make sure we get blood flow back to that hand, and that artery can supply that blood flow while we're getting the blood sample out of the radial artery. So that's an Allen's test. So with ABGs, it's all A's, right? We're getting our arterial blood sample and we're using an Allen's test. After we get the sample and we want to get just about 1 milliliter of blood, we're going to need to hold prolonged pressure over that artery. If we don't, then probably the respiratory therapist or whoever's doing the blood draw is going to get squirted with blood, right? Because this is your arterial system. It's your high pressure system. And we're going to need to stop that bleeding. So we're going to have to hold prolonged pressure for at least 5 minutes. If the patient's on anticoagulants, it may be a lot longer, but we want to make sure they're not going to bleed out. All right, so you have your blood sample, it gets sent to lab, and then you get your ABG results back, which will have the following components here, which we'll go into more detail now. So the first thing you'll get is the pH, which is essentially telling you the acid-base balance of the blood, whether acidosis is present or alkalosis is present. It measures the hydrogen ion concentration in the blood, and we would expect a value somewhere between 7.35 and 7.45. Then we have PaO₂, which is the partial pressure of oxygen in the arterial blood. That should be somewhere between 80 and 100 mmHg. Then we have the partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the arterial blood, which is PaCO₂. We would expect to have a value for PaCO₂ somewhere within the range of 35 to 45 mmHg. Then we have bicarb, which is HCO₃. So bicarbonate is an important buffer in the blood. It's regulated by the kidneys. And we would expect a value somewhere in the range between 22 and 26. Some textbooks and instructors use a slightly different range. And if your book or instructor uses a slightly different range, feel free to cross this off on your card and put that specific range in. However, it shouldn't vary too much. And when you're given a bicarbonate level that is out of range, it will likely be very out of range. So it shouldn't trip you up too much. Then we have SaO₂, which is oxygen saturation. It basically measures the amount of oxygen that is bound to hemoglobin in the arterial blood. And we would expect that to be somewhere between 95 and 100%. So when we are doing ABG interpretation, the key things we're going to be looking at are the pH, PaCO₂, and HCO₃. Those are the three key components that will help us to interpret our ABGs. So in my next video, we will talk about the different buffers that are in our body that help to maintain acid-base balance, and then we'll get into the details of the different acid-base imbalances, such as, you know, respiratory acidosis, respiratory alkalosis, metabolic acidosis, and metabolic alkalosis. So stay tuned.